Brought to you by
Eaton Detroit Spring, proudly made in the USA.
Classic car or muscle car, we want to show you how to restore your automobile and save yourself some money in the process. Sometimes we consult the pros, sometimes we mess up. But just remember, it's never a problem, it's always a project.
This week, Kara is out of town. I'm all alone, and we finished the tips and tricks for installing a 1965 Mustang inner fender apron and radiator core support.
Honey, what are you doing out there?
Waiting on the next Super Blowout 3-day only mega sale.
You don't need a sale. You need NPD.
NPD's everyday prices are competitive with most sales, and orders arrive fast from our four strategically located superstores. National Parts Depot has quality parts for Mustang, Camaro, Chevelle, GTO, Firebird, Ford, and Chevy truck. For your free catalog, go online or call toll-free.
Working beats waiting.
All alone. No help. Benny's working. And I gotta deal with all of this. But I'm okay with that. I actually have already gone in and done a slight fit on this yesterday evening. Everything looks like it's gonna fit up good. So what we're gonna do this week is we're gonna show you some more tips and tricks on putting this stuff together, how to set it up. The things you're going to need in order to make this work, because we've got a bunch of tools that we're using on this that aren't normal tools that you're going to need on most of your normal mechanicking work, and a couple of things that you're really going to need, like a good MIG welder. So we're going to go over all those tools in just a second, but right now I'm just going to go and kind of moan a little bit more because, as I said, I'm all alone by myself. But the nice thing is you can do this by yourself if you work at it. Okay, we've had a viewer write in and ask something, and we're going to go ahead and hit this now. Now, obviously, by looking at the front end, you see that we've already done everything to it. So this is actually shot post our normal Saturday shoot date. Now, what the guy asked was, should we have gone in and put something like a Monte Carlo bar across that engine bay in order to stabilize the shock towers from falling in on themselves? My answer to that is this. If you have the shock tower braces in the car and the frame rails are in good shape, and your floor pans are in good shape, you should be fine. You shouldn't need to do that. But if you don't feel comfortable, you can always go in and put one in either by tacking it in on top of the aprons across that area, or you can actually bolt one in using the upper bolt holes in the very back of the area where the bumper stop that goes on the outside of the shock tower bolts to. If you do that, then you don't have to worry about then going and grinding all that kind of crap up later on. So, yes, you can do it. Is it a good idea? Sure, if you feel more comfortable having that across there, by all means. But even in those instances, go ahead and make a measure just in case. Okay, on to tools. Okay, now, I have pretty much everything that you're gonna need whenever you're working on your car sitting on the table. There's gonna be some things I'll go into when we get in the middle of the episode, but it was really important for me to point these things out. Obviously, as of last week, you know that a drill motor is going to be very important. And in drill bits, whenever you're drilling out your spot weld holes where you want the spot welds to be, you're going to need a really nice sharp drill bit to do that, and you're going to need more than one because you're going to probably dull a bit doing the work. Clamps. Now, I will say that locking pliers, the best thing that you can do is to have a lot of them. On a core support, you're probably going to have to use anywhere from 6 to 8 of these, depending. And one thing that you will really need is these type with a U-clamp and then also a long reach U-clamp like this one to get over in the corner of the radiator core support. I'll show you a little more on that later, but this is going to be very, very important to the whole process. I have a bunch of them, and these are ones that I've just collected over the years, but if you're going to do it, you can probably go to a tool center, grab you up a bunch of these. They're not that expensive because you will absolutely need them when you're doing this kind of work. Another thing I grabbed when I was at the tool center was an air punch and flanging tool. I won't be using the flanging side of this so much as I'm using the punch side of it. The one thing I will say is when you punch with one of these, like we did on our battery tray apron, the hole size, in my opinion, is a little small to weld to for a guy like me who's not great at welding. Trying to get the tip down inside here to get a good solid rosette weld is going to be tough, so I will probably take these and open them up a little bit
in order to get a little more room for me to weld. If you're a really good welder, these small holes would probably be just fine. And it's kind of honestly good practice if you're going to fill in holes on fenders and whatever for medallions and emblems. Another thing you're going to need for what we're doing this week is a really nice side grinder. Now I'm using an electric because it's just a lot easier for me to muck about with. So you'll want one of these side grinders in order to do this kind of work. The last and most expensive thing you're going to buy is what's behind me, and that is a MIG welder. Now, MIG welder is going to be a big expense, and you need to make sure that you want to do all the welding work on your car when you go and you buy one. I wouldn't be caught dead without a MIG welder, and in fact, the 110 that's on the top is my uncle's MIG welder. The 220 underneath it is mine. 110, in my opinion, from what I've seen so far, is much, much better for going in and doing metal work on a car than a 220. The 220 is just too hot. A lot of times I can't pull it down low enough so where it won't blow holes in the sheet metal. So, in my opinion, for what it's worth, go ahead and invest in a smaller 110 MIG. You can go up to most sizes that you're going to be welding on a car with a 110. It'll be a lot harder for you to drop back on a 220. Plus, it's easier to be able to plug that 110 into pretty much bloody well any outlet in the house. And the 220, you're going to have to run it off your dryer, or you're going to have a custom plug for it. And that gets to be some more work. So, my opinion, do the 110, save yourself a little bit of grief. All right, so what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna go ahead and move right on over to the car and start showing you some tips and tricks on the pullout here and what we've got going on already on it and what I think you need to do in order to set the apron up. Better grab this. Right, so obviously I need my safety glasses for this because I'm going to be cutting and chips are gonna be flying. It's gonna be really cool. Everybody's gonna have a big time. Now, what I've got here is basically we've gone in now and already pre-cut all of our holes along the bottom apron, and I've drilled out the holes to about right here on the upper apron, and I'm gonna finish these up here in just a second. What I wanted to go into is this. You're gonna be going through a couple of drill bits. On this one, we had an old drill bit that we started with. We're on our second drill bit now. I don't know if that's gonna be a problem with you guys. It may not, but that's where we're at with it, so to kind of give you a little bit of a heads up. The other thing I've done here is you'll notice that I've marked these three holes right here that have not been cut yet because my drill holes are almost the same size as these holes, which are for this brace that goes right here. Now, this is your bumper brace on the car. So what I did is the doctor thing, which always kind of distresses me a little bit that doctors have to mark the leg that they're not going to cut. But what I did is I went in and I put bracket hole and I marked these up so that I know not to weld into these because I am going to put a couple of bolts in, but I don't want to put all three of these in here yet. The bolts will be in here to hold the apron in place, but if I leave a bolt out, I want to make sure I don't put a weld there and then have to go back in and cut it out. So that's what I've got going on right now. Now we're going to flip on the other side of the apron here and show you what you need to do after I finish drilling out the rest of my holes. Putting on my safety glasses that I got back from Vinny since he's not here this week. And I'm gonna drill me some holes. All right, now what I want to point out real quick is I've gone in on any of these spots where I'm going to be putting out, taking out the spot weld and putting a hole there for me to weld through is I've got a punch. I've punched it. I've got another drill motor that I go in and I put on the spot where I punched it. I put a dimple in it. And like I said last week in that episode, you'll want to go in when you're doing this and make sure that you just dimple all of them. But if you've got two drills, it makes this a lot quicker. What you'll want to do is you'll want to feel for your spot welds too, because I picked up one up in here that I hadn't noticed before. But that seems to be the only one on this side. So I'm gonna go ahead and get this one drilled with this, and then obviously drill the rest of these out. You don't need to see that. And then we'll go and talk about some of the other stuff you're gonna wanna do to get this thing ready for the apron to go in. Okay, next up. On this facing, I'm gonna go in and grind because I've got some places like right here, you can see this little tab of metal that actually came up whenever we were spinning the drill through there, and it just opened and peeled that sheet metal back. So I'm gonna go through and run the grinder through here in order to clean all that up so this sits, not the panel will sit nice and flat on there.
go back through and check them. These still need to be ground on a little bit, but that gives you the idea of what I'm talking about. You need to grind all of this stuff flat. The next thing I'm going to do then is I'm going to go in, I'm going to put the panel in, and what I'm going to do is going to be kind of a little different because I want to try to keep as much of this E-coat on here as I possibly can. I'm going to get my panel all fit and ready to rock and roll for position, and then I'm going to show you what I need to do to mark that up. All right, now the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to test fit my apron. I'm going to set it in position, and I've got a couple of the bolts from that brace I'm going to put in here. But I don't. Where's my nuts?
These nuts?
Got him!
Give me those.
The things I do to keep a steady job. So here's what I've got. I'm going to put a bolt from the brace in here and use one of my nuts to put this on. I'm going to tighten these up in a minute, but not yet. And I'm going to put another one in the top hole. Now, you wondered earlier possibly why I went ahead and marked these. I'm going to leave that middle hole empty just because I don't need to put anything in there. Now, this isn't going to be a be-all, end-all for my positioning, but what this will do is this gives me a marker. These have to be where they're at. So they need to fit, the panel needs to fit with these holes in mind. So you put this down first. You don't tighten them all the way in so you want, because you can get some movement out of them. And these can actually be your placeholders while you're trial fitting the front end. So now this is kind of in position where it needs to be. One of the first things I notice when I look at this is we got pretty good fit all the way through. Everything's laying up pretty nice. But I notice that I've got this piece right here on top, if you can see it, it's a little warbly. So what I'm going to probably want to do is to go in and actually flatten this back out. And I didn't do a real good job of it the other day when I was working on this because I didn't know how bad it was going to be. I didn't know if this piece needed to be perfectly flat. Well, now I've got this piece mounted and I can see that this is going to need some work in order to get it flattened out correctly and lay nice in position. You have another hole here as well. And on this one, there is no hole in the panel right here for this upper plate bolt. Again, for the shock tower brace. So I'm gonna have to drill that hole out. And these are the kind of things you're gonna find. You need to check this stuff out before you go too far. We know that needs to be drilled out, and I'll probably wait and actually open that hole up after we get everything mounted, finalized in position. That way it'll be a little easier to drill that and make that fit nice. I'm gonna talk about putting the radiator core support in position next. With all 7,684 clamps I've got for that job. There, should be enough clamps. Okay, now, what I've got here is my apron is in, but even with the two bolts in there, I still got some movement that I can do up and down. I think probably, owing to what I looked at yesterday, our final fit position is gonna be about right there. I may have to go in and open these holes up a little bit. What you want to do is on these cars, there's a little tab area right here. In other words, you've got the folded piece of metal here and it drops and it opens up, and this should sit right along that rail here. In other words, the flange of the panel should sit right here. You'll notice on the driver's side, it's the same thing. This one's out over the actual rail a little bit, and we may end up even doing that on this side where it pulls out some, but we want to make sure that we have those tabbed in correctly, and they are. I'm going to grab the core support and show you a couple of little detail items on this that I'm going to do because we're dealing with a driver, not a concourse car. If it was a concourse car, I probably would have just gone in and replaced the entire front piece because it would work better that way. On this car, since it's a driver, we're just going to do some repairs to the cross brace for the struts on this. On original cars, this tab faces to the inside of the rail, and there's really not going to be a good way to weld it in, but I want the rigidity I can get out of this by having that tab attached to the front apron as well as to the rest of the car, so I want to be able to pull these tabs. So what I'm going to do on this car, because it's a driver, not a concourse car, is I'm actually going to do a flip over. I'm going to flip this to where it faces the outside of the rail so I can actually get to it and weld it. We've already done the driver's side on this, and basically what I'm going to do is just put it in a vise and flip this around. But what I want to do before I do that, because I can still set this up and do a kind of a light test fit, I want to go ahead and put this in. I'm going to have to rock that in there that way. I'm going to of set this in position and kind of see what we've got. And oddly enough, we're actually looking pretty good. Our holes on this side are a little bit off, and I experienced that yesterday when I was messing with this. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to put a couple of clamps in position just to hold this here. I want one on the bottom inside here for now. And I'm going to put one each on the end. I'm going to put that on the end like that so that whenever it's set up, I know that my radiator core support is right up against the apron. I'm going to do the same thing on the other side. And I'm going to pull this so that the hole matches up. If I match the hole up, I'm a little bit out on this side, so I may come in just a tad. And I'm going to put this on here. And then here's what I wanted to make the point about using these long reach type of locking pliers, because over in this section, down on the core support over here, and I don't even know if these are going to be long enough to get down in that core support area, these are really great for going in and pulling the metal to on that core support, because I can get all the way into that corner if I need to. So that's going to basically set that up. Now what I want to do now is get my tape measure out, do some basic measures just to make sure that everything is still sitting the way it should be sitting. And then what we can start doing is talking about we're drilling holes in the apron so that when we weld to, you don't see anything from inside the engine bay. Everything is outside and hidden from the rest of the world, so to speak. All right, I'm going to start messing around with position on this, but I wanted to make a point because there is something you need to keep in mind of when you're working on the front end of the car, and that is this. The battery tray, a lot of times on these, will pull in. You'll notice that I've got more gap at the bottom of the front panel than I do up here at the top of this flange. And what you need to do is you need to take and push this out before you start your welding as far as you can get it to go and clamp it in position. If you don't do that, the battery tray is going to actually sit in from where it needs to be. Ford set this up so that these were able to be lined up pretty straight. I'm sure that there are probably a lot of these out there in the world that this line is not straight on them, but that's how it should be. And when you do that, it will actually tighten things up back here in the back section of the car a little bit as well. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to start going through and checking all my measures to make sure everything is going to lay flat. You don't want to start welding anything right away. Again, you want to go back in just like you did at first and do some measurements across stuff to make sure that everything's where it still needs to be. I'm going to grab my tape measure and I'm going to go in and measure the top from here down to the front of the apron. I will be dang. 40 inches, just like last week. Now the one thing I am seeing is it looks like this panel is popping out a little bit. So I'm going to go and check my measure across the back of that apron here in a second. But I want to go measure the other side just like I did this side. I'll do cross measurements to make sure everything is copacetic. And then if we run into a problem here, which I'm hoping we don't, I may have to do something to bring that out. But we'll go through and start checking all these and even checking our cross measurements, because it should be 46 inches from this edge to the back edge over here. So I'm going to go and make sure all my measurements are good to go. Here's a reason why I want you to keep all your original sheet metal unless it's just totally trashed out. Because things like what I'm running into right now is I want to check and make sure what I'm seeing on here is what I'm going to see on an original panel. You boy, with the apron in your hand and the moppish hair, bring me that thing. I want to show something here. All right, now what I've got is the original apron. And what I want to do is kind of set it up here in position as close as I can get it to the original or the new apron. And I noticed that our clip points are all coming in about the same position. Everything's kind of lining up. And it's got this weird line that runs down here. In other words, the clip points are straight across and run into the back of the car. And they're the same way on the original apron. So I know that what I've got here looks like an optical delusion. And that's exactly what it is. That's not going to be a problem because my clip line is good. Running to the back of the car, so I don't need to worry about that. It's just that the panel is kind of wumpy jawed looking because of it being the apron side of the car. This dipping in is probably giving me the eye that it's not exactly right. So now I know that that's okay. I can leave these clamped in the way they are. The next thing I'm going to do is start checking for position on this to make sure that my apron is at the correct height across the front. And I'm going to show you how to do that off of what we did last week. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to grab my tape measure and my straight edge that I used before. And one of the weird things I'll recommend is just kind of one of those things where I'm a little anal about it. I would recommend using the same tape measure and the same straight edge that you used before just to make sure that your measurements are accurate and the same. And we go across here, I'll be dang, 16 5/8. So now this apron and the radiator core support are sitting in exactly the right spot. I could go ahead and tie this down, but I'm not going to. What I'm going to actually do is I'm going to go grab something and do a little bit of paint work. And I'm going to show you why I'm doing that in just a second. All right, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take one of my paint pens and go in and mark my holes so that I can go back with a grinder or some sandpaper and knock all this E-coat off in the area where I'm going to be putting in my welds. I'll be pulling this back out of the car along with the radiator core support just so that we can do all of our weld up. Now there's a couple of places that I don't have my marks yet, but I want to go ahead and get this done just to show you guys how to do it. And basically this is that auto marker pen that we got from Larry a little while back, just like a regular paint pen. I'm going to go through then and mark these positions with my paint pen so I know where all my holes are. And that way I don't grind out as too much of my E-coat. I want to keep as much of that on here as I possibly can before I go in and do anything. Okay, now I'm going to go ahead and pull this out and mark some of these other ones up. And I'll do another reset, and then when we get all that done, we'll go in and I'll probably start doing some welding. Away we go. All right, now what I'm doing here is I'm going in and grinding the places that I marked with the marker on the radiator core support so that I can weld to this. And I'm going to also use some of this. Now this is a copper weld from some products, and this is what I'm going to use to spray on this. I'm going to take this outside and spray it up and then get it ready to go. Now this should help with the adhesion of the welds and also help with keeping this from rusting up underneath here, at least in theory, because it's copper, yada, yada, yada. Should work for this just fine. So I'm going to go ahead and get this sprayed up. I'm going to do this for all the points that I'm welding on here. Anything where I've got a white dot, I'm going to go in, use my grinder to grind it up, get ready to go. So get this thing done and I'll go out and spray it up. Okay, now what I'm doing is I'm going in and I'm tacking all this stuff in place. I'm not going to hit all the spot welds immediately. I'm going to go ahead and get this side tacked in, and then I'm going to move over to the other side of the apron, put a mild tack in on the hole over there, and then I'm going to move up to the top corners here, and then I'll put a tack in the back over there to get this thing laid in and make just one more assurance check that I've got all the measures exactly the way I want them. Everything seems to be lining up pretty good here. I'm hoping that we've got a good fit. The holes on everything line up still. It all looks pretty good. Remember, you do have some variances on these cars because, like I said, they had about a 16th to an 1/8 of an inch of variance on the front end anyway on all the sheet metal that's on the car. You could have an adjustment on it. All right, this is our final act here. I'm going to put the fender on. Before I finish everything up, I've only got everything on this side tacked up because this is where we did all of our work. So we want to make sure that when we put this fender on, it's going to line up everywhere pretty well. And all of our holes are lining up good all the way to the back of the car. When we shut the hood, even though this fender is a little kinked at the front, it's been mashed in into this corner. I've got a good straight line all the way to the back. Now these are repop fenders and they're older repop fenders, so my fender gap is pretty wide here. But I could also probably stand to move this hood over about a 16th of an inch, which would close up that gap. Well, folks, that's our show for this week. Do us a favor and come back and watch us next time on Auto Resto Mod. Have a great week, folks. I'm going to take the fender off and keep on welding. Yeah.